Our next speaker is, in my, I saw a glimpse of the respect and regard he had from not only from the community in Nepal, the technical community, but the community at large in Sendai at the UN Conference for Disaster Response, which I had a privilege to attend last year, or is it this year? It was just an incredible effort put by the United Nations, and our next speaker was had quite an impact. And this was predating the great earthquake in the Kathmandu Valley. Dr. Amod Dixit is the executive director of the National Society of Earthquake Technology in Nepal, NSET. His professional experience spanning 42 years covers stints with the government of Nepal, private engineering consultancy, also as a visiting professor of engineering geology and disaster risk management in Tribhuvan University in Nepal and the Kathmandu University in Nepal. He has worked extensively in Nepal and many Asian countries for disaster risk reduction and also for earthquake response. Mr. Dixit sits as a member of the governing board of the Global Earthquake Model, GEM, a global collaborative effort with the aim to provide organizations and people with tools and resources for transparent assessment of earthquake risk anywhere in the world. He is also a member of management board of the Asian Disaster Reduction and Response Network, ADRRN, of which he is a founder member. Dr. Amod is a recipient of numerous awards from all over the world, and he was inducted as a member of the Technical Advisory Group of the Global Disaster Preparedness Center, GDPC, of the American Red Cross in 2014. He studied mineral exploration at the National Mineral Resource University in St. Petersburg, Russia, geotechnical engineering in the Asian Institute of Technology in Bangkok, management in the Graduate School of Business in Stanford, and obtained his doctorate of engineering at the Graduate School of Science and Engineering in Japan. His speech today, excuse me, would be on the development and implementation of the National Building Code in Nepal, experience and challenges. And he will be followed in the same panel of speakers on a case study in Nepal. We'll talk more about it. But once again, we had asked Dr. Amod to join us before the Nepal earthquake without realizing the tremendous tragedy that was forthcoming. And subsequently, of course, he has been very actively associated working with international and the government of Nepal in the earthquake rehabilitation issues. So I really look forward to your presentation and share here. Dr. Amod?
Well, good afternoon, and thank you very much. It is so overwhelming to hear and to hear all the speakers, and it was so nice that many talked in languages that we were expecting people to be talking, and that was very nice, really. So I'll be talking next, please. Briefly, in the next 20 minutes or so, maybe 15 minutes, I tell you about how we developed the code, the Nepal Building Code, which dates back to 1994. What are the approaches that we took in there, and what are the problems of code implementation? What are the successes? Is there any silver lining, and what are the challenges? And then on the top of that, when we, in the last 3 or 4 years, when we started a serious approach towards building code implementation, and here is the big challenge by the April 2015, what we call the Gorkha earthquake. And then towards the end, I'll tell you why I'm here and what is our aspirations by our association with ICC and all of you. So the Nepal Building Code process started in 1988 when this small earthquake of 6.6 magnitude that virtually shook the entire country, not only physically, but also the politically. The country, personally, I believe that all the problems of Maoism that we had to witness was the result of this earthquake and the economic impact that it had, together with the impact that was created by the 1993 flood in South Central Nepal. So the government and the professional people, they all came together, and luckily we had a support, international support, through a consortium from in Canada based, but the leadership was provided by the New Zealand people, actually my friend, and that brought in the experience. So we were lucky to have that, and that way we could develop that that approach for a code which we think that we are very happy with. So this was based upon, next please, understanding the hazard, where we are located, what are the potential earthquake sources, what are the point sources, or what are the linear sources. And in this process, we also happen to consolidate our earthquake catalog. The area was defined. We looked into very comprehensively, and that helped us to understand the hazard. That helped us to understand something. I mean, evolve the understanding about what the code will do and what we are expecting from the code. Next, please. Now, together with the understanding of the hazard, we, right from the very beginning, we started out by understanding what the vulnerabilities we are facing. And to our surprise, this is the first time perhaps for me also, when we thought that the building code is the building code, the way you, I mean, everybody understands that, that was the solution. We understood, and here is my pyramid, that only about 7% of the buildings that are under the influence of the qualified engineers. 93% of the buildings, they are the building production mechanism, it is basically out of the engineering influence, or they don't incorporate the engineering knowledge. And that was a surprise. That time, it was perhaps the first in 1996, 2 years after the building code was created, we stood up and we said that, let us not spend money and resources in training the engineers. Let us spend money and resources in training the petty contractors and the masons who actually are the designers and implementers of the building production. So that is the understanding of the building stock of our country. I mean, mostly it is non-engineer, and that has gone into the consideration. And with this, we came out with, next please. The Nepal National Building Code in 1994, which essentially, next please, recognizes the non-engineered and also the rural buildings. So a four-pronged strategy was developed, which divided the building code into four different categories. The uppermost level one is for, you know, the users are the international consultant who are many there, and they are designing for larger programs, larger projects. They are designing anything which is higher than the Nepal building code requirements. The second level is basically professionally engineered building, the building code per se, and the users are the professional engineers. But then we understood that a larger part of the buildings are being constructed by, I mean, the engineering reach is not there. Maximum we could get the technical people. So this is basically pre-engineered. The level three is pre-engineered, which pre-engineers the stipulations of the building code into the concept, and that we call the rule of thumb, but we made it mandatory. So it is mandatory rule of thumb, and we created several documents for that, for the type of buildings, the masonry buildings, or the concrete buildings, or even timber buildings. And the last portion was that for the rural construction, it is the guidelines, because a lot of the users are the owner who also happened to be the builder. Next, please. And this four-pronged strategy was very, very useful for us in making the building code understandable even to the people who are not many of the petty contractors constructing even in the urban areas. They may be not the graduates of even high school, so or some of them may be even illiterate. Now, in this process, we did define what is the level of the risk that we are targeting. That way we cover all the materials that we use in our building production and all the production processes, the formal, the informal, and the owner-driven. And we understood that we are not targeting something, you know, something which the other developing countries would target. We said that it is from nothing to something. So it is from zero to the number one step, and then naturally it was close to the, you know, in terms of the materials used, we use the standards that the Indian code prescribes. Next, please. And we decided to use the building code through the legislative process. We made it mandatory rather than a good practice alone, and it was made mandatory for urbanizing and urban areas. And the classification was done. It is also made formal. Less than 3-story or less than 1,000, that would go into the mandatory rule of thumb or the pre-engineer. More than 3-story, it went into the professionally engineered. So it was very well defined, and larger buildings, they came into the realm of the level one, which is basically it is to take care of the presence of international consultant who would like to bring in, and the practice was that the British would bring in the British code, the Germans would bring the German code, and we assume that these codes are at high level or their requirements is higher than that of Nepal. So, and we were happy with that, but then when we started implementing the code, I mean, once the code was developed, it became so hot a thing that it was very difficult to hold it. Who is going to implement the code? Where is the capacity? So we started with two of the municipal areas. I mean, first our effort in Kathmandu, it was a sheer failure. Then we started doing in two manageable urban areas. In one is Pokhara, the very touristic area, and the other one is in the eastern Nepal. One was Pokhara was again a grand failure, but towards the east it became a grand success. So what we found that many people, even the technical people, forget about the administrators or the decision makers, they don't understand the intent of the code. It is difficult for them to understand. The one mistake that we did, that we gave the responsibility of the code ownership or the authority to the central government, and then the implementation responsibility to the local government, to the municipal governments, and that is a conflict of responsibility and accountability, somehow perhaps we were not very happy with the, or we did not go very much in terms of training the designers. They are not trained in the colleges or the university. The university, unfortunately, they don't teach our own building code. So what happens is that many of the products of our own engineering college, they don't understand what is there in the code and then the contractors also, if it doesn't go into the specification, the contractors also don't understand. So these are some of the difficulties, and then what I found that over the years, the building permit process is considered largely as a revenue generation for the municipalities. And to go from a revenue generation concept to a safety generation concept, it requires a lot of working with the, it's more of a work of a psychologist and sociologist than that of an engineer. And then erroneously we thought that we are the agent for doing that. And now we realize that. The same thing occurs when we say that, I mean, the authorities, the central government, were the enforcement agency which translates these code requirements into the building permit process, that's the municipality. But then the municipality doesn't have the capacity to supply. And the demand is also the people, the bottom up is not very proactively coming because they don't, again, the question of safety was not there. So this is one of the major difficulties. And then the traditional sort of difficulties like the cost increases or the people don't have much trust on the government. So every time the government takes an initiative, people think that, well, yet another bureaucratic hurdle or yet another, they are trying to rule us sort of a thing. So, and then the complexity of the entire process was not understood. Next, please. So in that situation, the demand was not much there, and the supply was also not there in terms of understanding. And even the engineers and the administrators, the mayors, they thought that if we have the planning bylaws, which controls the floor area ratio or the height of the buildings or the offsets, why should we need a code, things like that, and the institutional mechanism was not there. And the most important thing is, I said, it's a mindset. I mean, nobody wants to go out of the comfort zone that they have been living for quite some time. So there was a lack in explaining the code to the people, and the politicians were afraid of enforcement of the building code because that would, again, erode their vote banks and bases. There was a couple of instances when the municipal authority, they, in their meeting, they made a very important decision that they are not going to implement the building code, what the central government may make it mandatory, but they are not going to listen to the central government. So there were such instances also, largely because of the political consideration. Next, please. Well, nowadays we are talking about the peer review and professional liability and third-party monitoring things. We have even started in some of the municipalities, but then these were a very new concept, and even for us it was difficult to understand what is basically mean. The challenges are very many. We still have perhaps the next, please. Next, please. Yeah, the role of where is academia? What are the role of the developers and the implementers? The government still need to be defined. That's what we have learned so far. We think that, I mean, there are three basic process. We still have to work on the level of awareness of the people in terms of they should demand safety in the building permit process. And also the other part is that the municipality, they should have the capacity, both in terms of human resources and also in terms of the institutional mechanism for enriching the building permit process with this provision of safety into that. Another aspect which is there is that the local specificity should be understood. So far, we have been avoiding talking about the historical monuments. And if you go to Kathmandu, you see that it's a very old city. It is almost like it started being since the 7th or 8th century of this era. So we somehow found that these structures are too complex for us, and they are not very much addressed by the existing building code. And then the sensitivity of the land use, I mean the risk sensitivity of the land use is also not very well incorporated into the existing building code. Next, please. So despite these challenges, there are several silver linings. Earlier, when it was considered as the responsibility of one urban development ministry or department, now the local development ministry, also another ministry, also considering that, well, this is their also responsibility. So they are very positive. They have set of several policy instruments for measuring the implementation or encouraging the implementation of the building code, following the example of one that eastern city of Dharan. It is continuously proving that it's not a question of expenses, it's not a question of cost increment, it's not a question of something that you need to be very rich to be able to implement the building code. You don't need to be, I mean, it's even a poor, economically weak township or a country also can afford to have this safety in built into their construction places. So there was this example, and this example was taken by the ministry and studied and now being replicated in others in terms of the policy instrument that they have enacted. Next please. I'm trying to coordinate here also and there also. So where are we? Okay. Can we go back? So the Ministry of Local Development, they are also, I mean, they have recognized their responsibility. They have included when they monitor the performance of the municipality, the building code implementation has gone as one of the vital criteria for them to judge the performance and reward and punish. The building code is being promoted. The awareness raising exercise is being done by the other ministries also, and more importantly, they have allocated budgets for capacity building and for promoting this building code. Next, please. We are very happy in the last 5 years. Believe me, we are very successful in the implementation of the building code, and making the buildings safe. I must say that in this our elation of being happy, this earthquake took place in April this year, and after this earthquake, naturally, when something fails, then there is a blame game, and then as it happens, blindly people start thinking that once a building is destroyed, then the code has to be blamed and not us. So everybody talks about the revision of the building code, and then they talk about the retrofitting standards and others. But the problem is that that's very good, but the problem is that everybody is talking, most of the people are talking about these things, these issues, without even understanding what is what. Next, please. We do require a revision of the building code, even irrespective of the earthquake that has happened. When we made the building code in 1994, the tallest building in Nepal was 5-story or 6-story. Now we are constructing 22 and 23-story buildings or even higher. So they have got their own problems of load combinations and load distribution. So this aspect needs to be understood. Next, please. There is a big controversy now whether we should continue living with the 300-year return period as against the 500 return period or 475-100 return period. As we have got proliferation of the concrete building and the increased average life span has gone. So then several other objective requirements for the revision of the building codes, which is quite natural. We are already late in this revision of the building code. Again, the foundation aspect has not been treated very well, and then consequently the pre-engineered parts also should be revisited. Next, please. So these are some of the objective needs for the revision. And also we need to revisit our own hazard, understanding of our hazard, which was done in the early 90s. Our code was based on that, and the question of risk sensitivity of the different areas of urban areas, the microzoning factors, and also the economic implication or even the social implication of the code revision. If we revise it to make it very rigorous, then perhaps whatever attraction we have got from the people and from the administrator, we might lose that. So what is the level of acceptable risk? Perhaps it needs to be redefined again based upon the local situation, and then perhaps look into the political and economic implications also. That is what we think that we have next few years. And then again, it's not only the book that you have to revise or the method that you have revised. Actually, it is the implementation that is what enhances the safety. And well, the revision is easy, but the implementation is rather difficult and it's the main challenge. So what we see that sometimes we have to ask people, hey, come on, hold on. See, one has to understand that even without revision, if we implement whatever is existing now, we can achieve a lot of safety. I mean, from current position of, say, if we measure, it's a baseline of today, then a significant increase we can make it even by enforcing the existing code. And what we can achieve by revision is perhaps another 10 or 15% extra on the top of that. So, I mean, we are not against, although sometimes people think that why you are talking against revision, but what we see that we have to judiciously understand what we mean, and we have to emphasize or focus on actually the implementation strategy as against the revision of the code, which also we need to do. So with this note about the building code, again, going back to this Gorkha earthquake of April 2015, almost like a million buildings impacted, 800,000 buildings falling under the G4 and G5 category of damage, and then many more, you know, to lesser damage. Now, in this scenario, how do you look into the building code and what the building code is going to do in this reconstruction? Anyway, people are already home into reconstruction. Formal reconstruction is yet to start by the government, but then and the banks. But then, what is the relation between the code and this thing? And perhaps this is the one time in the life of many settlements that 1 million. Buildings are going to be influenced by this or that decision in terms of the building code. If we implement it, the safety is ensured. And we have proven that it is possible to significantly achieve in the front of building code implementation. Actually, my institution is now, I mean, before the earthquake, for the last 3 years, we have been helping the urban areas in the implementation of building code together with the government institutions. I'll tell you one thing. In the earthquake affected areas, there were 14 administrative districts. About 300 of school buildings, we could either construct earthquake resistant compliant to the building code, or we could retrofit those. The earthquake, it was an acid test for us. In those buildings, 100% of all the school buildings that we were working with, either new construction or retrofit, none of them suffered any damage. The other buildings that we did not address, 80% they were collapsed. Thanks God that the earthquake didn't come in the school days. And it came on a Saturday, which is a holiday for us, which is a weekend for us. So that shows that, I mean, there is a benefit in retrofitting. There is a, you know, benefit in all the money that we spend, and it's a very, very small amount of money. And it is a successful exercise. It can be done. It has got the social, technical, economic, whatever feasibility you see, because these are done by the local people, by the local mason, by the trained people, by the trained engineers, the young Nepalese boys and girls who have been trained on that. So we are very proud in terms of, you know, in terms of doing what we are doing, and it has been demonstrated as a success. So what we see that the challenge is there, and believe me, I mean, this learning about this implementing the code or revision of the code, we don't have very long experience of doing all these things. So naturally, we look forward to the global community to learn from the experience of this, and that's why that's why we are here to be talking to you and learning from you to be able to implement the building code to the 1 million or so building in the next 5 years. We are now facilitating this partnership within Nepal with the government. I mean, we are working together with the government, with the Reconstruction Authority, academia, and we have been assisted in this process by the USAID, the Office for Disaster Assistance, our trusted partners for the last almost 2 decades. And we want to develop this partnership also outside Nepal. And I'm thankful that, this travel here, it allowed me to talk to USGS and Caltech and Nepalese diaspora in San Francisco and also in Los Angeles area. So we see very positive response, and I think that we'll also get a very positive, we have been receiving positive response from ICC, from International Court Council, and we look forward to perhaps a more organized approach to this with the establishment of a chapter, ICC chapter for Nepal. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Amod. It's such an important and, in Nepal's case, a dimension that requires immediate and transformative experience. I apologize. This needs extended talk and extended discussion, extended QA. We will be posting the presentation. But one of the things I shared with Dr. Amod earlier this week is that ICC will seek to see what we can do, and I have spoken to a couple of other individuals, but in the coming weeks and months, ICC will definitely try and engage to see what we can do, working with other organizations too. But again, thank you for making this long trip from Kathmandu, and continued best wishes on your efforts in Nepal.